The University of Bristol is home to one of the world's best paleontology departments. Researchers here are constantly uncovering more secrets of the past by studying fossils and making comparisons to living animals. Every year, the university hosts a master's degree program where around 30 students each run their own research projects and can discover some truly amazing things. One of the major focuses of the work is looking at animal jaws. By looking at the jaw of an animal, scientists can deduce what it likely will have been eating. An animal like a lion has a strong, robust jaw with big, conical teeth. Clearly, this animal is a predator, perfect for tackling large and struggling prey. Compare that to an animal like this gharial. Its long, narrow snout will break easily if subjected to the kinds of forces a lion experiences when tackling prey. But that shape and those thin, narrow teeth are great for snapping at fish. Some animals even take this to an extreme. The giant anteater has completely lost its teeth and has jaw bones that have fused together, making it a thin channel for that extremely long tongue to poke through and gather insects. None of these ideas are new to science, of course, with jaw shapes linked to diet being one of the founding ideas put forward by Charles Darwin in his first descriptions of evolution. He noted that the finches of the Galapagos all display differently shaped beaks depending on their diets. For example, the large ground finch shows a stout and robust beak, perfect for breaking open tough food like nuts, whereas the small ground finch has a much smaller beak, its diet of little seeds not requiring anywhere near as much force. Importantly, this adaptation for purpose is not something seen only in living animals, but a characteristic of evolution that can be tracked back through the vast history of life on Earth. One of the Bristol Master's students, Steffi Woodgate, explored how the jaws of modern-day bats compared to their famous ancestors, the dinosaurs. What Steffi found was that the family resemblance was certainly present. Many of the dinosaur lower jaws had similar lateral shapes to modern birds. By quantifying their shapes in a special plot called a morphospace, Steffi saw a great deal of overlap between the birds and the dinosaurs. This means that they were likely fulfilling many of the same functions in their ecosystems. So it seems there's a little more Jurassic in your back garden than you may have thought. However, things get a little more complicated when looking at animals in the water. Here they need to think about more than just their diet. Having a jaw shape perfectly for your favorite food is all well and good, but it's not ideal if that makes your head such an awkward shape that it makes it harder for you to swim. Swimming animals need to strike a balance between the perfect jaw shape and what is most efficient for swimming. This was especially important for those icons of the Jurassic coast, the marine reptiles. Another master's student, Rob Loveday, showed that the fastest swimming marine reptiles, such as the ichthyosaurs, were the most affected by these hydrodynamic impacts. They relied on their streamlined shape to catch their food, and so we see them having these streamlined snouts cutting through the water like a dolphin. Slow swimmers, like the placodonts, didn't face such challenges and didn't need to be as streamlined. These animals were likely happier ambling through the water, nipping at invertebrate food on the seafloor. They can be thought of like the slow-swimming marine reptiles of today, the sea turtles. But what about the plesiosaurs? Some of those did develop long snouts, similar to the ichthyosaurs, but they didn't converge completely on the same shape. The reason for this is likely due to the way they were swimming. The four-flipper locomotion of the plesiosaurs was widely different to the undulating tail of the ichthyosaurs, and mean a very different set of hydrodynamic limitations. Jaws aren't the only bones that can tell us about an animal's behavior. Another highly telling feature are the bones of the leg. This can tell us how an animal might have moved, whether it was four-legged, a shuffler close to the ground, or a tall strider, covering vast distances with each step. Just like with the jaws, some animals have taken their adaptations to the extreme. Kangaroos are famous for their hopping movement, but this is only possible because their legs have evolved into effectively giant springs, able to elastically rebound energy and propel them forwards. But was this kind of movement something kangaroos have always done? This was a question looked into by Billy Jones. For her study, Billy looked at a kangaroo called Procoptodon, which lived in Australia during the Pleistocene, only a few hundred thousand years ago. Of all kangaroo ancestors, Procoptodon really stands out of the crowd, literally. At around 2 meters in height, Procoptodon is the largest kangaroo ever known. But could an animal over twice the weight of a modern-day red kangaroo move in the same way? By examining the size and shape of the bones, Billy calculated that it wouldn't have been possible for such a large animal to hop, and that it more likely would have walked on all fours. One surprising discovery came when Billy turned her attention to the front limbs of the animal. These were long and robust, suggesting that it may have been using them to dig into the soil. Perhaps, like some desert living animals today, it did so to find the nutritious roots and tubers buried just beneath the surface. This has been a very brief overlook of just three of the recent discoveries coming out of the University of Bristol Master's Program. We hope you enjoyed, and thank you for watching.